So now let's hear from David Barwell from AECOM. AECOM obviously were involved in the Heathrow Southern Rail scheme, which is a proposal privately financed. So David's got a lot of experience in this. David.
No, thank you, Richard. And Steve, thank you, because speaking on behalf of the private sector, there's a few things there which certainly we align. AECOM does invest in infrastructure, and going back to the early days, we were a founding partner of the Meridian Fund, which we no longer are. Then we have AECOM Capital, where we invest our own money in infrastructure projects. And I suppose the question that we're asking is then, with UK highways, why not and if not? About 18 months ago, we released our report, The Future of Infrastructure, where we interviewed 500 sort of global leaders. And sort of following that, we put together a sort of six points or key pointers that we said, what would need to change in order to encourage more private sector investment in infrastructure. What I've done now, what I'm just going to quickly just run through, is just made some adaptions to that to sort of look at it a bit more through sort of a sort of highways lens. So the sort of 6 points, starting off, firstly, we need to make it an asset that people are actually interested in. We need to promote highways infrastructure. In many cases, and when we talk to other third-party investors, they're actually pretty ignorant about this asset class. And to them, you can understand the sort of conversations that go around the dinner table when they're looking at highways as an asset. It doesn't jump out to them as one that goes, whoopee-doo, I'd be really proud to own a big chunk of infrastructure, when everybody would give a bit of ridicule talking about jams and potholes, slow lanes, years it takes to roll out sort of smart motorways and all the rest of it. And in some cases, poor user experiences. And obviously I know that Highways England are putting a lot of effort into this, but you need to look at it from the lens of, third-party investors. Quite often those investors are coming in from overseas. So we need to do more with what we have to attract investment. And we need to set projects up at the start to make them more attractive to private investors. Steve's touched on some of this, and I certainly won't dwell. But we could start by opening the conversation about value transfer and bringing the private sector in early to identify where is it that the private sector really brings value. And it's not just about dumping risk, although that risk can be mitigated, as Steve has mentioned, with cap and collar. It's actually early conversations about where can we really add value. And Steve mentioned to be clear about cost, because it's certainly one of these things. Cost is certainly, something which concerns other investors and the control of sort of, and a worry about costs moving out. One of the things that I would put out there, and again about early engagement, is around some of the contract structures we have. And I applaud the comment about DBFO, because one of the things that allows us to do is to really talk about how we engage the supply chain and bringing much more collaborative approach to contracting, where there's less handoff, where people pushing through the supply chain one risk onto another, and people having skin in the game right the way through the life cycle of the project, and that we can all bring. The other thing is to be clear about the revenue streams that Steve's dealt with, and when we identify the delta between, the capital cost and the revenue stream that we can get, this needs to be quantifiable. It's not a rude subject. It's something about, sitting down with government and the private sector with really quantifiable amounts and about really identifying who is responsible for what. The other thing is we need to create innovative financing structures and institutions. Equity partners need access to affordable debt, and with the UK leaving the European Union, we'll lose access to low-cost anchor finance from the European Investment Bank. So consideration should be given to establishing a UK investment bank. Then fourthly, we should consider more matching investors with different stages of a project. You know, where does that investment come in? And we mentioned, you know, the planning, Steve mentioned the planning cycle. If you look at sort of pre-DCO or post-DCO, pre-DCO is very much risk capital. And when you talk to the financial institutions and bringing in third-party capital, there is some interest in that in early capital. But what we're finding and what we found as, you know, through the market-led proposals in rail is around clarity about government stipulating around wanting to have competition at all stages of a project and even, you know, competing finance. So we have a project where, you know, pre-DCO, CC1-2, you know, pre-DCO, where we do have financial institutions and third-party capital coming in that'll say, we will fund that risk, because, you know, we fancy a bit of cash on the side. We will fund that, but we will do it on the basis that we get priority over, you know, putting equity in at the final stages in the ultimate delivery of the project. But they're not able to do that because that process needs to be competed. And so, again, you know, you're losing that ability of the private sector early on, being creative, coming in, being prepared to take some risk capital up front, and that all needs to be clear. Also some clarity about if the project doesn't go ahead or it comes under some sort of different guise, what actually is it the early investor retains at the end of the day? Do they even get the intellectual property rights over the idea? We also need to move projects outside of the political cycle where we can, and, you know, shift in government policy, of course, presents a block to private investors, particularly, you know, people from overseas that don't understand the, you know, sort of political nuances. And there's plenty of good material out there. You know, Highways UK has the Roads Infrastructure Strategy. There's the National Infrastructure Association reports. ICE have got the state of the nation. There's private sector reports like AECOM and other large organisations all sort of talk about these and great plans. And all these set out clear objectives. And government should make it very clear around a national important infrastructure, and so we can secure bipartisan support for a national roads strategy. And finally, one just really to reach out to all of us in the industry, touches back a little bit on the first point, which I think all of us have got a job to sort of think about, to change a mindset, to really think about a growth mindset, to talk very positively about the assets that we've got, the real benefits that highways provide to all of our communities, how it's brings in much improved urban development, improves our urban environment in our cities, and by improving great transport infrastructure. And if we all take a positive mindset, we all take a growth mindset with respect to our highways, we start to change the language. And so these are sort of like six quick points that I'm just suggesting we do to help encourage some more private sector investment in highways.
Thanks, David. Take the politics out of infrastructure.